The love of God, the light of Christ, and the power and communion of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Good evening and welcome to this virtual Maundy Thursday service with the United Even Apart Church of Santa Fe. Wherever you are geographically and wherever you are in your life's journey, we are glad you are continuing the journey of this Holy Week with us, even apart here at the United Church. The Maundy Thursday service is one of the few services we offer at nighttime, in the shadows. The only other services are Ash Wednesday that began this journey 6 weeks ago, and also Christmas Eve, when we gather to remember the birth of light into this world. Tonight's journey takes us into shadows. It takes us into fear. It takes us to the courts of Pilate, and finally tomorrow, out to the hill called Calvary. It is good that we take this journey together. And so I thank you all for being a part of this service tonight. As we begin our time together, you might want to dim the lights in your wherever it is that you are. And by the end of the service, turn out the lights completely, because this service ends in total shadow. As we remember, however, the light that shines in such times, and that the darkness and shadows have never overcome. And so now, my friends, I invite us to gather for worship this night, as we do every time United Even Apart Church gathers, by taking into our lives God's gifts. So let us breathe in deeply the gift of God's peace that this world seldom can give. Let us breathe in deeply the gift of God's hope for us and for this whole world. And let us breathe in God's deep, abiding love that will not let us go and will not let us down. And even the powers of fear and death itself could not, has not, and will not ever overcome. Let us gather this night and continue this journey. Please join in the call to worship.
We have gathered in the presence of God, our Creator, who sets before us ways of life and death.
We have gathered in the presence of Jesus Christ, who calls us to accept the cost of discipleship that we might know its joy.
We have gathered in the presence of the Spirit, who sustains us in trial and rejoicing.
In our living and our dying, we belong to God.
In the shadow of God's wings, we sing in hope. People of God, let that hope lead us through the journey of this night.
Tears.
As we prepare to engage God's word and take this journey into the shadows, let us open our hearts and our lives and be together in a time of prayer. Let us pray. O God, you who are always more ready to hear than we are to pray, and ready to give more than either we deserve or deserve, open our hearts to you this night, that we might know the abundance of your love for us and all people. Forgive that which we are afraid to name, heal that which has been broken, and guide us in the way of your peace. Amen. I invite us into a time of silent prayer. The one who is always more ready to hear than we are to pray, ready to give more than either we desire or deserve, the source of abundant love and grace that never ceases to amaze. That is the one in whom we have our trust, and the one who will walk with us every step of the way on the journey of this night and into the day ahead. Let us sing our praise. Let us be in praise with this one of abundant love. Amen. Many stories that are told about the last night of Jesus' life, the night that we remember on a Maundy Thursday. Tonight we hear two stories, one from the Gospel of Luke and the first one from the Gospel of John. The first story from John tells the story of what happened at the Last Supper. The second one, told in the Gospel of Luke, is Luke's account of Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. I invite us to open our hearts and our lives to hearing these stories and perhaps hearing them anew this year. Because, as I've often said, we don't just interpret Scripture. Scripture interprets us. And we are in a very different time than we were, certainly, the last time we heard these stories a year ago, and even more so, the last time we were able to be together and worship, more than 2 years, almost 3 years ago now. And so let our hearts and our lives be open to the reading, hearing, and understanding of the story of the Last Supper from John's Gospel, offered by Nathan Kingston, and then the story of Jesus in the Garden, according to Luke, offered by Madeline Kingston.
Story of the Last Night. Now, before the festival, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and go to God. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. And during supper, Jesus got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. After he had washed their feet, had put on his robe, and had returned to the table, he said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me Lord and Teacher, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and Teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another, just as I have loved you. You should also love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another.
Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me
a second story of this night. After the meal, Jesus came out and went, as was his custom, to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed him. When he reached the place, he said to them, "Pray that you may not come into the time of trial." Then he withdrew from them about a stone's throw, knelt down, and prayed, "Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done." Then an angel from heaven appeared to him and gave him strength. In his anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down onto the ground. When he got up from prayer, he came to the disciples and found them sleeping because of grief. And he said to them, "Why are you sleeping? Get up and pray that you may not come into the time of trial." Word of God, word of life.
When Jesus wept the falling tear, in mercy flowed beyond all bound. When Jesus groaned a trembling fear,
when Jesus
the gospel writers don't agree on what happened that last night, at least in important parts of the story. Three of the gospel writers don't even mention the foot washing that John focuses on. And the three gospel writers, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, who do talk about the Last Supper and the bread and the cup, they don't agree on which came first, the bread or the cup. They also don't agree on what happened in the garden. All four of them tell about the garden story of Jesus going with three of the disciples to the Garden of Gethsemane, leaving them behind and falling down to pray. But they don't agree on what all happened then either. And even the Gospel of Luke itself doesn't agree sometimes with itself. There is more than one version of Luke's Gospels, Luke
the Gospel of Luke's account of the Garden of Gethsemane scene. In one version, probably the earliest version, there's no angels. In the version we heard tonight, there are angels that come and strengthen him in his agony in the garden. So what can we believe about these stories? I'd like to put forward some things tonight. Whether at the Last Supper Jesus gave them bread and cup, or Jesus focused on washing their feet, those 12 disciples must have been exhausted, to the bone weary, by the time they got to the Last Supper. Because they'd traveled down from Galilee, they'd had to make all kinds of arrangements for the donkey, for the processional, for returning the donkey, finding the upper room, getting everything ready for Passover. And in between all of that, they'd gone from the shouting Hosanna crowd 4 days later to huddling in an upper room somewhere. Because in between times, Jesus kept going back into the temple, arguing with the religious leaders. And so the tension must have been growing and growing and growing. And even though the gospel writers don't specifically state how exhausted, to the bone weary they were, they must have been. How could they not be? And so whether it was that Jesus washed their feet or gave them the bread and the cup, in that weariness, he reminded them of his love and God's love for them. He fed them. He quenched their thirst. He bathed their feet. He loved them to the end, according to John's gospel. And maybe that's the most important thing to remember. That line from John, having loved them throughout the whole time together, he loved them to the end, whether it was with broken bread and a poured out cup or water in a basin. And he loved all of them. That's another important thing to remember, is that in all four of the Gospels, Judas is still with the other 11 during the Last Supper and during the foot washing. Which means that when Jesus broke that bread and said, "Take, eat, this is my broken body, broken for you," he was referring to Judas as well as the other 11. When he poured out the cup and said, "This is the new covenant poured out for you, for the forgiveness of sins and the newness of life," he said that to Jesus. He said that to Judas as well as the other 11. And when, according to John, after supper, he took a towel and girded it around his waist and a basin filled with water and went around the room with each one of them, taking their dirty, smelly, caked with mud and dust and dirt feet into his hands and washing those feet, he washed Judas's feet as well. So even if the Gospels disagree on some of the details of the story, they agree on the most important things. The weariness and the fear, the exhaustion of the disciples living in a world that kept turning upside down. And the ways in which Jesus cared for them and loved them to the end. Let's remember that this night. And when we get to the Garden of Gethsemane scene, the one where on the other side of the Kidron Valley, he's gone up the Mount of Olives and is kneeling down somewhere in that garden that still exists to this day, alone, having left his three disciples behind. As I said, Luke doesn't agree with Luke as to whether or not there were really angels there that night. And in fact, in most modern translations, that line about angels coming and strengthening him is put in parentheses ambiguous angels, one might call them, because there's different versions of how Luke told the story. So what do we know about this story? What can we count on? Well, we can certainly count on the fact that all four gospel writers wrote or somehow shared what they had remembered or been told what he said that night. That he started out with a prayer of, let this cup pass, an honest, to the bone prayer of fear of what was going to come next. They don't disagree about that. And they also don't disagree about what the prayer was later. Not my will, but thine be done. Somehow casting himself upon God's love and God's care, no matter what the future would bring, no matter what that night would bring. And so whether or not there were angels there that night, we don't know for sure how he made it through that time of prayer. But we know that he did. And we also know from the story as it unfolded over the next less than 24 hours, from the time of his arrest all the way through the crucifixion, there were also, if not heavenly divine angels, but other angels along the way, human angels. And all four gospel writers write about them. The women who wept as he was being led off to be crucified. Simon of Cyrene, who was pressed into service to carry his cross when he couldn't do so any longer. The centurion at the base of the cross, when he breathed his last and finally said, and the centurion said, according to Mark and Matthew, truly this was the Son of God, but in Luke's gospel, truly this man was innocent. That somehow, no matter what the man, what the centurion actually said, he realized that something had happened that should not have happened, and that this man who hung dead from the cross was who he said he had been. And then in John's gospel, as well as in some of the others, there is Joseph of Arimathea, who goes to Pilate. Joseph of Arimathea, who is a member of the council but had disagreed with what had gone on, goes to Pilate and begs for Jesus' body to be put into his own tomb. And quite likely, as that was being done, there were the women who stood off from a distance, keeping watch, bearing witness to what had happened. Yes, Luke's gospel is ambiguous when it comes to those angels in the garden. But Luke and the other gospel writers are not at all ambiguous with the fact that along that terrible, horrible journey, there were angels even then. In Simon of Cyrene, in Mary Magdala, and other women, in Joseph of Arimathea, and Nicodemus, the Pharisee who had come by night. And so, my friends, I invite us this night to find our own place in the story. Whether it's in the story of the Last Supper, whether it is that we are being fed or our feet are being washed, but to find our place with those disciples, to name our fears, our weariness, our to-the-bone tiredness, and anxiety about what comes next. And in all of that turmoil and fear for ourselves, for our people, for this world, to also know that there is one who feeds us and cares for us, washes our feet, and loves us to the very end. Find yourself in that story. and find yourself also in the story of the garden. And even if you've never experienced a divine angel with wings of gold and halos and song, remember the angels that have walked with you in your journeys in the same way that Simon of Cyrene, Mary of Magdala, Joseph of Arimathea, Nicodemus the Pharisee, and all the others along the way who proved to be angels in that terrible journey for him. Who have been the people in your life who have borne witness for you and borne you up? Who are the people in your life who, like Simon, have carried your burdens, your cross? Who are the people in your life, like Mary Magdalene, who have gone the whole distance with you to bear witness? And who are the people like Nicodemus and Joseph who did what they could? And so tonight, let us find our place in this story. And let us know that we are not alone in taking this journey, that there is one who has gone before us and one who still walks with us, feeding our deep hungers, quenching our deep thirst, washing away our fear, our sadness, our exhaustion, and walking with us to new life. That is God's will, and that is what he did. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Let us be together in a time of prayer. Let us pray. Gracious God, who loves all and forgets none, We bring to you our prayers this night for all your people and all your creation. For all whom we love, watch over, and remember, hear us, O God. For all who, like Jesus, are broken in body, soul, or mind, from physical affliction or loneliness of heart,
hear us, O God.
For all who, like the women and disciples around him, are troubled by the suffering of those whom they love,
hear us, O God.
For all who, like Peter and Judas, are overshadowed with doubt and fear, may your light still guide them.
Hear us, O God.
For all like those whom Jesus sought to help, who are oppressed by poverty or hatred, for all forgotten by us and this world, may they know they are remembered and held dear by you.
Hear us, O God.
For all the peoples and places of our world broken by illness and hunger, greed and violence, may they know your healing power and our love and commitment.
Hear us, O God.
Hear all of our prayers, O God, the ones we offer aloud and those we offer in the silence of our hearts. Hear our prayers as well of thanks for the angels among us who have strengthened us in our time of need. Hear us in our silent prayers. Hear all of our prayers, spoken and unspoken. Answer them according to your will, and through the remembrance of this night, make us channels of your infinite grace and love for this planet and all living things. Through Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. Amen. According to the Gospel of John, the scripture story that we heard earlier, on that night of betrayal and death, he chose to kneel before each one of those disciples, even one who would betray and the other one who would deny and all the rest would fall away, to take their feet into his hands and to wash them, to let his hands show forth God's care, God's beauty, God's love. And so before we proceed with the story of this night in words, we will offer a ritual of hand washing, taking into our hands one another's hands, and offering God's care, God's beauty, and God's love.
The tempter. Then one of the 12, who was called Judas Iscariot, went to the religious authorities and said, "What will you give me if I betray Jesus to you?" They paid him 30 pieces of silver, and from that moment, he began to look for an opportunity to betray him. When it was evening, Jesus took the place with the 12, and while they were eating, he said, "Truly, I tell you, one of you will betray me." And they became greatly distressed and began to say to him one after another, "Surely not I, Lord." He answered, "The one who has dipped his hand into the bowl with me will betray me. The Son of Man goes as it is written of him. But woe to that one by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that one not to have been born." Judas, who betrayed him, said, "Surely not I, Rabbi." Jesus replied, "You have said so."
And when they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. And Jesus said to them, "You will all fall away, for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered.' But after I am raised up, I will go before you to Galilee." Peter said to him, "Even though they all fall away, I will not fall away." And Jesus said to him, "Truly, I say to you, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times." But Peter said with great passion, "If I must die with you, I will not deny you." And they all said the same.
And he came out and went, as was his custom, to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed him. And when he came to the place, he said to them, "Pray that you may not enter into temptation." And he withdrew from them about a stone's throw and knelt down and prayed, "Father, if you're willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done." And there appeared to him an angel from heaven, strengthening him. And being in an agony, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down upon the ground. When he got up from prayer, he came to the disciples and found them sleeping because of grief. And he said to them, "Why are you sleeping? Get up and pray that you may not come into the time of trial."
Thank you. journey to Gethsemane, go and feel the tempter's power, your Redeemer's conflict see, watch the anguish of his hour, do not hide or turn away, learn from Jesus how to pray.
Follow then to Pilate's hall, you the Lord of life arraigned, crowned with thorns and mocked by all, faithful leaders pain sustained, greater still than shame or loss, Jesus now must face the cross.
Calvary's mournful mountain climb, see the Savior lifted high, mark the miracle of time, God's own child is sacrificed. It is finished, Jesus Christ. Learn from Jesus how to
while Jesus was still speaking, suddenly a crowd came, and the one called Judas, one of the 12, was leading them. He approached Jesus to kiss him, but Jesus said to him, "Judas, is it with a kiss that you are betraying the Son of Man?" When those who were around him saw what was coming, they asked, "Lord, should we strike with a sword?" Then one of them struck the slave of the high priest and cut off his right ear. But Jesus said, "No more of this." And he touched his ear and healed him. Then Jesus said to the chief priests, the officers of the temple police, and the elders who had come for him, "Have you come out with swords and clubs as if I were a bandit? When I was with you day after day in the temple, you did not lay hands on me. But this is your hour and the power of darkness."
Look on me with your favor, O Then the guards seized Jesus and led him away, bringing him to the high priest's house. Peter followed at a distance, and when they had kindled a fire in the middle of the courtyard and sat down together, Peter sat among them. Then a servant girl, seeing him as he sat in the light and gazing at him, said, "This man also was with him." But he denied it, saying, "Woman, I do not know him." A little later, someone else saw him and said, "You also are one of them." But Peter said, "Man, I am not." And after an interval of about an hour, still another insisted, saying, "Certainly this man also was with him, for he is a Galilean." But Peter said, "Man, I do not know what you are saying." And immediately, while he was still speaking, the cock crowed. And the Lord turned and looked at Peter, and Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said to him, "Before the cock crows today, you will deny me 3 times. And he went out and wept bitterly.
As soon as it was morning, the religious leaders held a consultation with the scholars and the whole council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate, the Roman governor. Pilate asked him, "Are you their king?" He answered him, "You say so." Then the religious leaders accused him of many things. Pilate again asked him, "Have you no answer? See how many charges they bring against you." But Jesus made no further reply, so that Pilate was amazed. Now at the festival, Pilate used to release a prisoner for them, anyone for whom they asked. Now a man named Barabbas was in prison with the rebels who had committed murder during the insurrection. So the crowd came and began to ask Pilate to do for them according to his custom. Then he answered them, "Do you want me to release for you this man Jesus?" For he realized that it was out of jealousy that the religious leaders had handed him over. But the leaders stirred up the crowd to have him release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate pointed to Jesus and spoke to the crowd again. "Then what do you wish me to do with this man?" They shouted back, "Crucify him!" Pilate asked them, "Why? What evil has he done?" But they shouted all the more, "Crucify him!" So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas for them, and after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified.
Thank you.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The Word was in the beginning with God. In the Word was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the shadows, and the shadows have not overcome it. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, full of grace and truth. And we have beheld its glory.
Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever.